the same hurdles.
And what is happening to our weather?
Indeed.
Reports.
Very wet and windy down here this morning.
It is. I was almost blown off on the bridge.
Absolutely.
Reports this morning talk of winds reaching 100 miles an hour. We've sent Claire off to West Scotland to give us the weather from first-hand experience. Claire, oh, it doesn't look too bad.
No, it's lovely here. Positively balmy, Penny. Yeah, no, at the moment, gusts are only up to around 60 miles an hour, but it's actually going to peak around 90 miles an hour. That may cause some severe disruption. It's enough to blow down trees and also cause damage to buildings. So I think the worst of the weather this morning is going to be around 10 o'clock to around 2 o'clock this afternoon. So I may just escape it, but it's very windy down here. And not only goes for central and southern parts of Scotland, but northern areas of England as well as Northern Ireland as well. Now, further south, gusts will reach around 50 miles an hour. For the north of Scotland, that's where it's going to be coldest today with some outbreaks of rain and winds maybe a little bit lighter than they are here. Now, most places will be affected by showers. They, luckily, it's dry at the moment. I've got a feeling it may not end up that way. It may get a bit soaked a bit later, but I will give you more details in a little while. Now it's back to a warm and cosy studio and Penny Smith.
She didn't sound at all envious. The top story this morning, it seems there's no end in sight for Britain's beleaguered rail commuters after last week's strikes in the north of England. It's the turn of passengers in the south to suffer again. Staff at South West Trains are staging another two-day strike in an ongoing dispute over pay and conditions. Our correspondent Richard Gaisford is at Waterloo Station. Richard, good morning. What's the latest?
Well, more cancellations, Penny, more delays and more chaos for the hundreds of thousands of people who'd normally be using South West Trains to make their journey into work in the capital today. The managers here at South West Trains are doing their best to lessen the impact of this strike by the RMT guards. 100 of the managers are on the trains this morning acting as guards, but they can't do enough to actually keep normal services running. 600 of the 1,700 services will be running for everyone involved this morning. There'll be a bus journey, there'll be a change or a stop at a station you wouldn't normally go to. And certainly the RMT is doing its best to make journeys into work for people today very difficult indeed. They say their guards aren't getting enough pay, their conditions aren't right, and there's also a dispute about the demotion of one member of the union who was working for South West Trains.
And this isn't the only strike action in the pipeline, is it?
No, that's right. There's a continuing campaign amongst drivers of ScotRail up in Scotland to get better conditions up there and better pay up there. They want to be paid the same as other drivers in the rest of the United Kingdom. There's trouble brewing as well in the Midlands on the Silverlink service and also in London here on the Docklands Light Railway. RMT members there are going to be balloted about pay and conditions, industrial action over that. The problems continue on South West Trains tomorrow, but also in February as well. On the 12th and 13th, the third of the two-day strikes comes and hits home here. And at the moment, Penny, it seems there's no end in sight and no way of stopping it.
Richard, thanks very much. Speak to you again a bit later on.
Time now, 3 minutes past six. Here's Kate with the rest of the news. Good morning, Kate.
Good morning to you. And good morning to you too. The family and friends of two British terrorist suspects being held by the US in Cuba have expressed their shock and disbelief. Asif Iqbal and Shafiq Rasool both come from the town of Tipton in the West Midlands. Lara Logan joins us from there now. Good morning to you, Lara. So the family of Shafiq have been expressing their dismay then.
They certainly have, Kate, and everybody I've spoken to here has said that neither of these two young men were, in fact, radicals. I'm standing outside the home of Shafiq Rasool, whose two older brothers came out late last night and expressed their shock. They said the family's been completely traumatized. They have absolutely no idea what the events are that led up to his capture in Afghanistan. They say he went out to Pakistan to do a computer course. And the other young man, Asif Iqbal, they say went to Pakistan sometime earlier to get married. And they don't even know how the two men could have met up at all, if indeed they did. So a lot of confusion, a lot of shock, and they described last night how traumatized they've been.
It's been like going to hell and back, especially for our mother as well.
I don't think he's got anything to do with any fighting or anything. He's a very, very nice person. If you ask anybody about him, his character is got a very, very nice character.
And the family wants Shafiq brought back to Britain to face questioning then.
Yes, they certainly do. I mean, you can imagine what it is like for them. He's thousands of miles away. They haven't been able to see him. They haven't seen any pictures of him. The only assurance that they have that he's all right is the word of Foreign Office officials who say they've spoken to the prisoners there and there's been no complaint. They are amongst three Britons who are actually imprisoned in Camp X-Ray, along with Ferez Obosi from Croydon. And one of the things that the brothers pointed to last night was the the treatment of the prisoners in Camp X-Ray. This has been very controversial. And U.S. Defense Secretary Donald Rumsfeld actually visited Guantanamo Bay yesterday, and he defended the treatment of the prisoners. And one thing he was emphatic about was that the U.S. would not be changing their status, and they would not be classified as POWs. So obviously major concern there from the families, and they'll be asking the government through their MP to give them more information and more assurances.
Lara, thanks very much indeed. Thank you. Thousands of workers in job centres and benefit offices begin a two-day strike today over a tax on staff. The nationwide stoppage is part of a long-running row over the removal of security screens. The government has promised security guards and CCTV cameras, but union leaders say staff concerns are being ignored. Foreign Secretary Jack Straw will push for sanctions against Zimbabwe when he meets members of the European Union today. He's threatening to hold back almost £80 million worth of aid if President Mugabe doesn't stop his campaign to silence critics. The EU also wants Mugabe to allow international observers to oversee the election in March. Britain's bracing itself for more stormy weather. High winds over the weekend left a trail of destruction. In Southampton, a 60-foot tree crashed into a house, while a tornado was reported in Cheshire, and blizzards caused havoc on the roads in Scotland. It's 6:07 now. I'm back with an update at 6:30 now. Here's Penny. Morning.
Thanks very much. We're coming up on the News Hour, a special investigation into the crisis gripping many of Britain's accident and emergency departments with Dr. Hilary Jones.
Half an hour ago, this corridor was empty, but now, as you can see, it's full. This lady's got medical breathing problems. This gentleman's got abdominal pain. This guy is completely out cold. This lady's got a problem with her knee. Over here, we have someone who's been assaulted. And on my left-hand side, it's an overdose case.
We'll have more on that real-life casualty in about 10 minutes' time, but right now, look at the papers.
A look at the front pages. This is the front page of The Mirror, talking about shocking videos of murder and mutilation may have lured Britons to Osama bin Laden's terror network. That's what they're saying there. The Daily Mail saying America has poured scorn on British concerns over the treatment of al-Qaeda suspects in Cuba. And a picture of Prince Andrew at a rather marvellous party on Saturday that I was at. He wasn't the only person there. Exactly. Liza Minnelli was there, Shirley Bassey. Kids take 2 million ecstasy tablets a week. That's the front page of the Daily Record. And Jackie Bramble's stateside gossip. Look, new column there. Airlines may be sued by people victims of economy class syndrome. And a marvellous story in The Sun, I don't need a man. And as Kate Garraway so aptly observed, you do need one. Where else would you wipe your feet?
I shall maintain dignified silence and tell you what's in the rest of the papers. The broadsheets, for example. Britain to send back Afghan refugees may be sent home on the grounds that Afghanistan is now a safe place, according to government spokesman quoted there. Cuba, Britain's barred from POW status. They're still going to be treated as unlawful combatants. Interesting phrase that the Americans have used. And in the Daily Telegraph, the woman's suicide bomber shakes the Israelis. Terrible scenes there once again, I'm afraid, from the Middle East. Penny.
Well, none of the papers today going on our main story, which is about the rail passengers and the terrible problems facing rail passengers up and down the country, particularly this week in the south. They're facing another struggle to get to work with more strike action on southwest trains. And that comes hard on the heels of industrial action last week, if you remember, in the north. We decided to see what it was like to travel this morning. Our reporter David Prescott is travelling from Alton in Hampshire to London's Waterloo, and normally that journey involves just one train and takes about an hour. Not today, though, because David has to take a coach from Alton to Aldershot, then has to take a train from Aldershot to Woking, and then at Woking he faces a wait of nearly half an hour for another train from there to Waterloo, and it's likely to take 2 hours. So let's catch up with David, who should be on a bus at the moment. David, where are you?
I'm on the bus. Can you hear me? We're just reversing. You, believe it or not, Penny, it doesn't bode well because the actual bus turned up 7 minutes late, right from the beginning. We're supposed to leave at 5:45. It turned up at 5:51. We've just turned up to Bentley, which is the second station on our little coach route, and that was after the driver actually took a wrong turning, so we've turned up here late as well. So at the moment I can see it's 6:10. We're supposed to be here at 6 o'clock. Now I've got to get to Aldershot for 6:30, as we were planning to do. Now the way it's looking at the moment, my connecting train goes at 6:40, so it looks like I may be running late, because then I'd be waiting another hour for a train to take me from there to continue my odyssey.
That's if you do actually miss the train, of course. So what's the mood of the other commuters, particularly since you're talking into a mobile phone at the moment? Probably very irritated with you, aren't they?
At least I'm not saying I'm on the train.
I'm on the train! Yes, quite.
But no, the problem is, well, most people are half asleep anyway, but it doesn't really fill us with much hope, so knowing we're running 10 minutes late, because obviously we need to make that connection at 6:40 for Muldershot, so really, fingers crossed, we'll have to see what happens.
All right, next time I speak to you, David, I'm sorry to interrupt you, we'll actually run out of time for this particular moment, but we will be tuning in again when hopefully you will say, I'm on a train. Speak to you later.
Speak to you soon.
OK, 11 minutes past six is the time now. It's been another great weekend of FA Cup action, particularly if you're a Manchester City fan, more of that in a tick. But sadly, once again, the back pages make grim reading for the authorities. This is typical of the back page this morning. This must stop, a reference to the coin thrown at a Liverpool player at the Arsenal v Liverpool match over the weekend. Let's talk now to Gordon Taylor, Chief Executive of the Professional Footballers Association, who joins online. Gordon, good morning to you.
Good morning, John. Congratulations on City's win.
Thank you very much indeed, Gordon. Thank you very much indeed. We'll come to that a little bit later with Brian Wilner. But let's talk sadly about this incident at Arsenal. Unquestionably, the right decision by the referee to send off Jamie Carragher, who threw that coin back into the crowd.
Well, it is, but we've got to concentrate on what is the main problem, of course, and that's the players and the officials. It might well have been thrown at one of the officials because Jamie was near the referee at the time. And this has been the last in the spate of incidents about the last 2 weeks, you know, with the last round of the FA Cup with Cardiff, then we had it at Chelsea.
And what can the clubs do about it, Gordon?
Well, what is strange in football is suddenly we have copycat incidents and you have a particular pattern developing. Well, we've got closed circuit television, we've got all-seater stadiums, and the supporters themselves must know who's throwing things.
Would you support any club that said, if they found the person responsible, that's the last time you ever come into this ground, and hopefully the FA take the same action and ban them from any ground in the United Kingdom?
Yes, I would, because to that extent, you know, this could cause serious damage to the eye of the assistant referee on the line or any player. I mean, what they were talking about sport. I don't understand why this is having to come back. It's just incredible, I find. And supporters themselves were the ones who made a big difference last time in policing themselves. They will know who's thrown it. This closed-circuit television action's got to be taken. We don't want to talk about perspex fencing coming back.
And what, meantime, is your directive to your members, the players?
Well, they can't afford to retaliate, but it was at Arsenal, if you remember, where a spectator got onto the pitch to have a go at an Everton player just last season. And sometimes the police and stewards say, oh, let it happen, let it run. But sometimes it's a human reaction to retaliate and for the players to take that human reaction. So it's really important that stewards and police get their act together.
OK, Gordon. Well, thanks very much indeed for getting up to talk to us. We're joined now by Brian Wilner, who's chief sports writer for the Star and the Express. And that's the headline over your copy this morning, Brian. Ref was right, right, right. That's a reference to the three sendings off, of course, which we'll have a look at now. First of all, Mr. Keown, who was tugging somebody's shirt. Let's just have a look at that, shall we? You think he was absolutely right, yeah?
No option at all, because he's the last defender, that's the law, and someone's free on goal, and if you pull the shirt back, I'm afraid the referee has no option but to send you off.
Yeah.
Keown, very disappointed, but I'm afraid that referee Mike Riley, who's got a controversial record this season, has no option at all. And I don't know why they're complaining bitterly, really, because had it been the other end, the Arsenal players have been surrounding the referee saying he's got to go.
Absolutely. And then the Dennis Bergkamp one, which we'll have a look at now. When I saw it, first of all, I thought it was a harsh decision by the ref, but when you look at it again, there was an intent there, wasn't there?
Straight away. The intent was why he was sent off. Had he connected, that could have been a serious injury. Bergkamp had lost it because of the sending off of Keown. Again, Riley, no option at all. Those tackles, no part in football.
All of that coupled with the incident we've already dealt with and Jamie Carragher throwing the coin back into the crowd.
That's a worry, John, I have to say. The coin throwing, it started at Cardiff and the authorities have got to stamp down on that very quickly. They haven't done anything yet since Cardiff and they're dragging their feet over it.
Yeah, and you see, that made you almost forget a great goal by Dennis Bergkamp in the match.
Because Dennis Bergkamp, of course, has a disappointing record in the FA Cup. He missed... Well. the final when they did the double. Only came on for a few minutes last season. But this was a great goal. 2-1, won the touch passes.
Fabulous play by Henri a little bit earlier too, to control it, get out of the wing there and make that cross. So congratulations, Arsenal. They're on the way through and they deserve it after that victory. And congratulations to Cheltenham. Great giant killers against Burnley.
There's a bit of romance left in the cup, isn't it? I'm slightly worried about it with what's happened this week with a small crowd at Middlesbrough, very strange kick-off times, the draw at Sunday night. But Walsall on Saturday and Cheltenham yesterday just keep it alive, don't they? I'm not sure if all the big clubs and all the major players are heartbroken anymore at going out of the FA Cup.
Yes, that's the worry.
Because it's not the major trophy it was.
Except you see games like that, you see...
It does, yes. I mean, this obviously brings it to life, yeah. And this is what the romance is all about. But there aren't enough of them.
And you, of course, would expect me to say nothing else, but what a great game at Ipswich last night.
It was, yeah.
Pity for the Tractor Boys, but a good victory for Manchester City 4-1.
Well, City are now the top scorers in football, aren't they? And Kevin Keegan is doing a remarkable job, as we expected he would, and his reward is a fairy tale return to Newcastle.
Absolutely, yeah. And people are saying, is this the goal of the season from Berkovic? Our Nick Berry look-alike.
Wonderful volley by Berkovic, but if the keeper, going to his left, if he gets there, he should save it.
As I've told you, Berkovic has scored a better one at Main Road a couple of weeks ago. But that'll do for me, that'll do. 4-1 away from home, not bad. Now we've got Newcastle, that's got to be the game of the round, hasn't it?
It'll be the television highlight, won't it?
Yeah.
They'll come down hard on Keegan's emotional return. Yeah. And he'll get a great reception from the Geordies because of what he did for them. But It is certainly the match of the round.
OK. Brian, thanks very, very much indeed for being with us. Let's hope we do not see any more of that appalling behaviour which we witnessed.
It's certainly a worry, and the authorities this week have got to do something about it.
And Arsenal being the club there, I'm sure, will crack down on that as best they can, because they're responsible.
Does that mean I've got to, by the way, just talking about City, does that mean I've got to stop telling that joke about what's blue and white and sliced down the table?
Yeah. You have got to stop telling that joke, I'm afraid. Right. Yeah.
Oh, I thought it was rather amusing. I didn't understand it, of course.
No.
You'll have to think of another one.
You'll have to think of another joke. Done. The time is 17 minutes past six. Now, what's going on with the weather? We've seen everything from snow to high winds, floods and even a tornado. And all here in Britain. And it's certainly blowing a gale today on the west coast of Scotland, which is why we've sent Claire Nazir there. Claire, good morning. I'm waiting for the plague of frogs. What's going on?
Good morning, Penny. Well, over the last 3 days here in Gourock, they've had a hard frost, then they had an inch of snow. Then on Saturday, the snow was replaced by rain as heavy rain moved in from the southwest. And then when I arrived yesterday, it was quite calm. I was thinking, what is all the fuss about? Then obviously I woke up this morning to strong winds. The winds are going to get worse through today. It's not only, though, across Scotland, it's across the UK as a whole over the weekend. Let's have a look and see what happened.
High winds battered the shores of Britain over the weekend with gusts of up to 70 miles per hour in some places. In Cornwall, a pregnant woman and her young son had to be rescued from their car as floodwaters threatened to engulf it. Even being in the comfort of your own home was no escape from the weather. There were reports of a tornado in Alsager, Cheshire. The wind sent branches crashing into homes and lifted roof tiles. The picture was just as miserable across Scotland, with the northwest, Western Isles and Highlands being hit by heavy winds. And there'll be no respite for the next few days. Storm force winds of up to 90 miles per hour are on their way.
Emma Maxim reporting there. Claire, the big question is, why?
Well, if you remember, you cast your mind back to December, it was the sunniest month on record, sunniest December on record, and that's because we're influenced by high pressure. Now, that high pressure has declined to Europe, that's where they're getting the sunshine, and so instead we've been bombarded by deep depressions coming in from the Atlantic. Now, in December, these depressions were hitting Iceland, now they're hitting us, and unfortunately, I think there's going to be more to come over the next few days, but today's going to be the particularly bad day with strong winds. It's not only winds, it's rain as well.
Thank you very much. We'll speak to you again a bit later on. Go and have a cup of nice, warming cup of tea.
The time now, 19 minutes past six. A very good morning to you if you're just joining us. The crisis facing the NHS took a new turn at the weekend when two senior consultants broke rank and went public over what they called appalling conditions patients have to endure in accident and emergency. The pair from the Kent and Canterbury Hospital apologised to patients and said staff can't take much more.
On Wednesday, there were some virtually 40 patients in our A&E department, and it reduces our nurses to tears. Our staff are bending their backs and sweat, making their brows sweat, trying to look after people as best they can under second-rate circumstances.
Well, the NHS Trust responsible for Kent and Canterbury says it's taking action to improve the situation in its A&E department, spending £2.1 million on doubling the capacity of two of them and improving facilities at the third. So is the Kent and Canterbury an exception? We decided to put one of Britain's busiest A&E departments to the test this weekend. Dr. Hilary Jones joined the long and stressful night shift at the Leicester Royal Infirmary. Here's his special report.
Casualty departments have been very much in the news lately, but what really goes on behind that reception desk? How long do patients really have to wait? And what are conditions like for the staff who work here? I've come here to the Leicester Royal Infirmary, one of the busiest A&E departments in the whole country, to find out the truth. It's 10:30, their shift is just about to begin, and so's mine. Let's find out what it's really like.
It's 11:30 p.m. 15 patients have already come through, including this one, a case of deliberate self-harm, who, having been initially treated in one of these cubicles for deep lacerations to his right arm, is now being transferred to the surgical unit.
This is 17-year-old Daniel Roberts. Today he's had fever, disorientation, dislike of bright lights and a splitting headache. He came here through casualty at about 20 to 10. He was seen immediately and referred to the medical assessment unit. He's got a suspected diagnosis of viral meningitis and he's awaiting a lumbar puncture, which he'll have in the next few minutes. This is 20-year-old James Brown, who has a history of heart disorders. He has pain in the left side of his chest and down his left arm and hand, which feels numb and tingly. He arrived here in casualty almost on the dot of midnight, and I think it's fair to say he was brought into resuscitation fairly quickly. How many minutes before you were brought through to resuscitation, James?
Just under 5 minutes.
Just under 5 minutes. And Dr. Jenny Baines has been looking after him. Jenny, what sort of condition is he in?
He's very well at the moment. He'll be staying with us initially for some tests. He's had some x-rays and some blood tests, but we're certainly going to be keeping him in overnight.
Half an hour ago, this corridor was empty, but now, as you can see, it's full. This lady's got medical breathing problems. This gentleman's got abdominal pain. This guy is completely out cold. This lady's got a problem with her knee. Over here, we have someone who's been assaulted. And on my left-hand side, it's an overdose case. These patients are on trolleys because they can't wait in the waiting room. They've just been brought in ambulances, and they'll be quickly assessed in the next few moments and then taken to wherever is appropriate. I'm just about to go up to the medical assessment unit now to see how other patients have fared.
I'm now back at the bedside of Daniel Roberts, who had his lumbar puncture for suspected viral meningitis earlier. It's now 10 to 3 on Sunday morning. The doctor's with him. How's he getting on?
Well, he's done very well. I mean, I think he's already better than he was when he came into hospital, Hilary, and his lumbar puncture is good news.
This A&E department serves 1.2 million people. It copes with 350 patients every single day, and 98% of beds are occupied. Effectively, the beds are always full. Professor Brian Williams says that despite the various difficulties, staff are fully committed to caring for patients.
What we've done here is we've expanded the availability of acute medical beds within a medical admissions unit. We've staffed it with frontline staff. We have many more nursing staff here, and there have been many more innovations which have been put in over the last year.
It's now 6 a.m, approaching dawn. There have been busier Saturday nights here, but still 85 patients have come through A&E. There's been violence outside the hospital, the usual abuse of staff, and two nurses have been threatened and assaulted. There's been one complaint as well. The vending machine was vandalised, and patients and relatives couldn't find anything to eat.
As you can see, Hilary joins us. I found that absolutely riveting, and thought that while we're out enjoying ourselves on a Saturday night, those people are going through that. And that's just a typical night. I mean, nothing exceptional about that night, was
that it? That was a quieter night than usual for them. That we saw 85 patients during that time, and it can be a lot busier than that. Mm.
And that's one of the things that, although on average you get one patient every 4.8 minutes coming through, sometimes they'll all come at once.
Exactly.
And that's when it hits crisis.
I mean, I don't know how long it is since you were back in a casualty department. Were you a bit surprised by the volume of work they had to get through?
No, I don't think the volume... the volume perpetually changes and increases, but what has happened is the changes have been put in place since I was a casualty officer at the Royal Free some years ago. They have assistants now who can take ECGs, electrocardiograph recordings of heartbeats. They've got people who have trained to take blood, so it takes the pressure off the junior doctors to some extent, but there's still enormous pressure. But they've put in these changes which actually make it better. There are improvements have been put in place.
What was the morale of the doctors and nurses like, particularly bearing in mind, as you said at the end there, and as is so often the case, two of them were assaulted during the course of that evening.
One nurse was locked in the triage room by one patient and two of his mates.
Drunk,
she was
presumably.
Very distressed, yes.
Yeah.
And she was upset and distressed. Another nurse had been punched in the face by a disturbed patient. This is part of the course, as part of their routine work.
Just at Leicester, which is stressed, but
not
all
just
over
at
the
Leicester.
Country.
Leicester's a busy unit, but it happens. It's a nationwide problem. Security is present, but it's really minimal.
Tony Blair has staked his reputation on getting the NHS back in working order this morning. He's quoted in all the papers saying if it's not up and running as it should be by the time there's an election, you can feel free to sack me. Has he got any chance? Will he still be our next Prime Minister?
Well, quite. I mean, I think there's an enormous task facing him. I think he needs to go and spend a couple of nights on Saturday night in a busy casualty unit and see what the problems are. I think I take my hat off to the guys and girls at Leicester. I mean, two of the managers gave up their night to help us, gave us free access. Mm. Professor Williams there, he wasn't actually on duty that night. He came in specially and was on duty for us. Mm. And they're absolutely dedicated to the care of their patients in difficult circumstances.
And they did that. They came in to make a point.
Yes, and what was very interesting for us to know, and hopefully I've revealed it there, is that although you see patients on trolleys, you see pictures in papers of patients on trolleys, those patients on those trolleys were only there a few moments. Mm. They'd come straight in from the ambulances, and they were already being processed. They were on their way to cubicles and bays, where they'd be quickly assessed with blood tests, ECGs, X-rays, whatever was appropriate, and then moved to the most appropriate areas of the hospital, whether it was the surgical unit, medical assessment unit. And whilst they were actually waiting, whilst they thought they were waiting and hanging around, their blood tests were being processed in the laboratory, their X-rays were being interpreted, as were their ECGs. Mm. Things were happening. They may have felt like they were waiting around, but actually they were getting very good medical care. It's good
one example of health service working as it should do. And thanks to the staff there for helping you and helping us make that programme.
Here.
Still to come on the News Hour, we'll be catching up with David Prescott's commute on strike hit Southwest trains.
And we're talking big babies again at 10 to 7, and I do mean big.
Yeah, he does. And Claire's on weather duty, live but wet from the west of Scotland. That's after the break.
You're at home, having a lovely cup of tea, when all of a sudden, something extraordinary happens.
Hello, Jerry. It's Chris Tarrant here on Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. Good evening.
Oh, good evening.
Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? Tonight at 8:30.
I was drunk and I can't believe I did it.
Stop it! I don't want to wear it anymore.
I need you to leave me alone.
You look like you're enjoying yourself like you'd never enjoyed yourself before.
Go on, let's see. Are you deliberately trying to humiliate Kyle?
Well, maybe if you give me some of the time you give to getting Daniel back, I wouldn't need to go and look out.
If you leave me, darling, I've got nothing left to live for.
It's all kicking off.
Give us a top-up, love.
Footballers' Wives, Tuesday 9, ITV1.
Don't miss the exclusive interview with screen legend Barbara Windsor. You're in good company with GMTV.
Bleating lambs and distant pastures, buttercups and summer frocks. These and many things I think of when I sniff my old pop socks.
Good morning. This morning I'm down in Gourock, which is on the edge of the Clyde in Strathclyde. Now, behind me is the Clyde and just ahead is Dunoon. Now, a lot of ferries go from Gourock down to Dunoon. I think there's going to be a few rough crossings this morning into this afternoon, and that's because the wind is so strong. Now, at the moment, gusts are up to around 50 miles an hour. They're likely to peak at 90 miles an hour. Now, the problem area is going to be central and southern Scotland and northern areas of England. As I said, gusts up to 90 miles an hour. I think the winds will gradually ease as we head towards the latter part of the afternoon. But during that peak time, I think it could actually cause problems with blowing down trees and also some damage to buildings. So the Met Office has issued a severe weather warning for gales in this region. Let's have a look at the southwest of Scotland this morning then. Not only wind, but we are expecting some blustery showers to blow in. And that will be typical of western areas of the UK during this morning into this afternoon. I think the best of any weather is likely to be across East Anglia in the southeast, but even across the southern half of Britain, it's still going to be a very windy day indeed. I think gusts could actually reach about 50 miles an hour here. Now across northern Scotland, we are expecting some rain today, and showers in the west may actually merge with longer spells of rain during the day. So if you are out and about, do wrap up warm and remember to take an umbrella. Now, temperature-wise, it's not too bad, really. Temperatures up to around 10 to 12 Celsius. 12 is 54 degrees Fahrenheit, but please watch out for that wind, gale force winds, and I think the winds will ease later on, but still it's going to be a very breezy evening. As for tomorrow, tomorrow is going to be a case of sunshine and showers, and watch out, more rain coming in from the west. Let's have a look at the summary then for today's weather. It's rain and showers in the west, a very strong wind, gale force winds, some sunshine in the southeast.
Claire, thanks very much. Good morning. It's 6:31 on Monday, the 28th of January. I'm Penny Smith.
And I'm John Stapleton. You're watching the News Hour on GMTV. In the next half hour, we're live to the West Midlands for reaction to the news that two Al-Qaeda suspects being held in Cuba come from Tipton in Staffordshire.
And we meet the mother who gave birth to a rather large baby, and she gave birth naturally as well. But first, thousands of travellers continue to face yet more misery this morning due to further rail disputes. Last week, if you remember, commuters in the north of England were hit by industrial action on Arriva trains. Well, today, commuters on South West trains face disrupted journeys to work. Well, Richard Gaysford is at Waterloo Station. Richard, good morning.
Yes, good morning, Penny. Well, every single departures board inside the station tells the same story. Either the services have been cancelled or you'll have to stop and change at the station or even take a bus instead of the train. It really is a problem for the 100,000 or so people who will be using South West trains today to make their journey into the capital for work. The managers of the company are doing their best to limit the impact of the action by the RMT on the passengers. 100 managers have taken up duties as guards today. It is the guards that are on strike. This isn't about drivers at all. It's about guards' pay and conditions. The managers doing their best to try and keep things running, but they can only get 600 trains out of the normal 1,700 on the tracks today. So that means lots of people having delays, lots of people having their services cancelled, and trouble tomorrow as well. This is a two-day strike.
Yes, two-day strike at the moment, but this isn't the only strike action around, is it?
No, that's right. There's continuing campaigns for drivers up in Scotland on ScotRail to get parity with their paying conditions with other drivers in the rest of the United Kingdom. So they're going to be voting on strike action there. There's trouble brewing in the Midlands on Silverlink and here in London on the London Docklands Light Railway. The RMT balloting people there on striking for pay and conditions as well. And as well as the misery tomorrow for people on South West trains, it's going to happen again in February. On the 12th and 13th, another series of strike actions here. It seems that nothing can be done to stop this trouble on the railways at the moment, Penny.
Richard, thanks very much.
33 minutes past six, the rest of the news now with Kate.
Good morning to you. Good morning. The family and friends of two British terror suspects being held by the US in Cuba have expressed their shock and disbelief. Asif Iqbal and Shafiq Rasool both come from the town of Tipton in the West Midlands. Lara Logan joins us from there now. Good morning to you, Lara. What have the family of Shafiq been saying to you?
Good morning, Kate. Well, they've been describing how traumatised the family is by this news. It came as a complete surprise. I'm in fact standing outside Shafiq Rasool's home, and this is where his two brothers came late last night to speak to the media, to talk of their disbelief, and to just say that they don't understand how this could have happened, that he went out to Pakistan to do a computer course, disappeared, and they didn't hear anything more until they were told that he had turned up in Camp X-Ray. Now, the other young man, Asif Iqbal, they say he went out to Pakistan sometime earlier to get married, and they don't even know if he connected with their brother at all. And this is what they had to say last night.
It's been like going to hell and back, especially for our mother as well.
I don't think he's got anything to do with any fighting or anything. He's a very, very nice person. If you ask anybody about him, his character is he's got a very, very nice character.
So, Lara, what do the family want?
Well, they obviously want their brother to be brought back to Britain, that if he is to face any charges at all, that he face charges here in his home country. They have absolutely no idea how he is. They haven't seen any pictures of him. They say they don't even know how his health is. All they have to go on is what they're told by Foreign Office officials who have, in fact, seen the prisoners in Camp X-Ray. And so they're desperate for more news. They want to know what charges have been brought against them. And I think they're just desperate for some kind of contact. They're obviously very, very worried. Recently, the death of a young baby in the family, and their mother is said to be completely traumatized.
Lara, thanks very much indeed. Thank you. Thousands of workers in job centres and benefit offices begin a two-day strike today over attacks on staff. The nationwide stoppage is part of a long-running row of the removal of security screens. The government has promised security guards and CCTV cameras, but union leaders say staff concerns are being ignored. Foreign Secretary Jack Straw will push for sanctions against Zimbabwe when he meets members of the European Union today. He's threatening to hold back almost £80 million worth of aid if President Mugabe doesn't stop his campaign to silence critics. The EU also wants Mugabe to allow international observers to oversee the election in March. Sport now, and Arsenal's victory over Liverpool in the FA Cup was tarnished by three red cards and more crowd trouble. Liverpool's Jamie Carragher was sent off after he was struck by a coin which he threw back into the crowd. He's since publicly apologised but awaits a disciplinary verdict from the FA. Also sent off were Gunners Martin Keown and Dennis Bergkamp. And in the next round of the Cup, well, Manchester City's manager, Kevin Keegan, gets a trip back to his old club, Newcastle. Arsenal at home to Gillingham or Bristol. And the only all-premiership tie sees Middlesbrough take on Blackburn. And third division Cheltenham Town, in the fifth round for the first time in their history, travel to West Bromwich Albion. 6:37, very happy John Stapleton this morning. Now it's time for the news, weather and travel, wherever you are.
Good morning from the Granada newsroom. Actor Sir Ben Kingsley has told a special gathering in Manchester that what happened during the Holocaust may never be properly understood. The Jewish-born actor, who starred in three films about the Nazi atrocities, was among 1,000 people who attended last night's event at the Bridgewater Hall. It was organised as part of National Holocaust Memorial Day.
I am always shaken to find that there is collective grief in all of us. And rage, and I think if we tap into that, we might ensure against it happening again. However, I know that as I speak, it's happening somewhere in the world.
A Kurdish refugee is seriously injured in hospital after being found outside a police station in Greater Manchester. The man in his mid-30s was found collapsed outside Chadderton police station in Oldham late on Saturday night. It's alleged he was attacked in Werneth, where he'd been living since he arrived in England last year. Two men, who are also Kurdish, are being questioned by detectives. Thousands of job centre and benefit office staff from across the region are starting a two-day strike today. Talks to resolve an escalating dispute over safety have broken down again. Stephen Chapman has the details.
Up to 60,000 staff in job centres and benefit offices are set to strike again in the biggest civil service industrial action in 15 years. It means so far almost 300,000 days have been lost in this single dispute. The reason is the new style Job Centre Plus offices, which no longer have safety screens to protect workers. The public and commercial union says this puts staff at risk, a belief highlighted earlier this month when another worker was attacked. Union officials claim there are three violent attacks in job centres and benefit offices every week.
Time now to take a look at the situation on the region's roads. In Greater Manchester, the M60 has bridge work. In Cheshire, speed restrictions and cameras on the M62 around Warrington and Burton Wood. In Lancashire, the M6 is being resurfaced around Leyland. And finally, on Merseyside, roadworks on the northbound carriageway of the M53 between junctions 2 and 3. I'm back with more news at 7:05. Next, the region's weather.
The weather in your region with Vinos.
It'll be very windy this morning, especially in the north, with gusts around 70 miles an hour in exposed spots. That'll make driving difficult in places. Then this afternoon, a mixture of bright spells and blustery showers. The winds will begin to ease during the afternoon and evening. Top temperature 11 Celsius, 52 Fahrenheit.
Welcome back. You're watching the NewsHour on GMTV. It's 20 to 7 on Monday, the 28th of January. Coming up, what makes two British men in their 20s turn to the Taliban in Afghanistan? We're talking to their MP live from the West Midlands in 5 minutes' time.
Right now, let's take a look at the morning papers in Afghanistan. On the front page of The Independent, Lord Rooker, the immigration minister, saying that Afghan political asylum seekers may be returned to Afghanistan because it is now, in his view, a safe country. And the Daily Record up in Scotland, a very interesting story here, saying that according to official surveys, youngsters are now taking 2 million ecstasy tablets every year, 200,000 every weekend in Scotland alone. All that below the news that Jackie Brambles, our Jackie, started a new column for the Record, and in the Mirror, the tapes of terror. This is another reference to Afghanistan, the tapes apparently in circulation to help recruit people from countries like the UK to the Taliban cause.
We're going to be talking about that in a few minutes' time. On the lighter end of the market, we have this piece in the Sun here about the fact that a group of classic car fans have grown their own Jaguars out of a hedge. Oh, sorry, that's my shadow in the way. There you go. So, rather marvellous. And I just thought this was great. You know, this this woman who rode across the Atlantic.
Yeah.
You know,
after,
and her husband. Yes, exactly. And her husband sort of abandoned her, really. And I just like this.
In fairness, he had a problem. In fairness,
yes,
he had a huge problem. Yeah.
He did have a problem. To be fair, and he left. But then it did mean that she was left to then row it.
Her choice. Yeah.
To row it alone, as it were. And I like this. Wife's kiss for husband who let her row the Atlantic alone. Look, so no hard feelings. You see, it is no hard feelings.
I'm sure. Yeah, that's right.
It's great. I think it's fantastic. Lovely. Can you imagine rowing into Barbados?
Can you imagine rowing all the way from where she rode from, on her own?
No, I can't. But I'm just saying how lovely at the end of that, at the end of that,
to
just
of
all the places to go. How lovely to go into Barbados.
Oh, OK, it's 18 minutes to 7. You're watching the News Hour here on GMTV. And don't need me to tell you, the winter of discontent continues on the railway. Strike action on Arriva trains in the north may have ended, for the time being at least. But now passengers on South West trains are suffering further misery as a two-day strike begins this very morning. Our reporter David Prescott is taking a journey on South West trains this morning up from Alton in Hampshire to central London. Now, normally the journey involves one train and takes 1 hour 7 minutes. Today it will take more than 2 hours. That's because he's having to take a coach from Alton to Aldershot, then a train from Aldershot to Woking, which he should be on right now, moving ahead rather more quickly than our graphic. He's then got to go and wait 25 minutes for another train from Woking to Waterloo. Well, let's find out how's it going. David, good morning. How is it going?
I'm on the train, John.
Excellent news.
I tell you what, Kate Garray might have been round the world, John, but she should try getting in from Alton on strike day. I tell you, it's a far more grueling experience. The way that it's worked at the moment, we just got in with minutes to spare into Aldershot. The bus driver who picked us up turned up 6 minutes late for my first start at Alton. He then missed the turning for the second station and then had the bizarre thing of people actually telling him where to go. Not physically, like, but just telling him where to drive. We then got into Aldershot about 2 minutes ago, so we're now heading towards Woking. I should get in for about 6.55, and I sort of got that wait from there. But it doesn't bode well, John.
It doesn't. Well, we'll keep us in touch. We'll be talking to you throughout the programme. Meantime, all the very best to David. And we're joined now by Andrew Haynes, who's the Managing Director of South West Trains. He's down at Waterloo Station for us this morning. Good morning to you, Mr. Haynes. Headlines in several papers this morning saying, "I'll break the rail strikers," quoting people working for your organisation, saying that if these men continue this industrial action, they're going to be replaced. Is that right?
No, it's not right. I'm not sure where those stories have come from. I'm a trade unionist. I have been for 17 years. We have no intentions of taking that sort of action.
Well, they're actually quoting Brian Souter, who's one of your colleagues.
I know Brian Souter obviously well, and that's not his plan. Our plan at the moment is to train more and more managers so that if the strikes go ahead, and we very much hope they don't, then at least we'll be able to provide an improved service to our customers.
So you are recruiting staff in the belief that this may go on and these people may no longer be with you. So it's almost right, this story, isn't it?
No, we're recruiting staff as part of our normal turnover. What we're doing for strike days is training up more and more of our existing managers.
Okay, now that begs another question. You're training your managers to become guards rather rapidly, leaving the thought with many people, what about safety?
We've not compromised on safety one jot. Every single manager has had to pass exactly the same assessment as any new guard. And the HSC, the Health and Safety Executive, have vetted our procedures. It's simply not true that we're doing it with any undue haste.
But I'm puzzled, Mr. Haynes. I'm puzzled, Mr. Haynes. I mean, your managers didn't join your company to become railway guards, did they? So what's going to happen in the next few weeks? I mean, they're not going to carry on doing that, are they? Surely you are going to recruit new people.
Well, we can't recruit and train enough people to replace 760 guards. That's why the story that's appeared is rather silly. What we're doing is training managers so on strike days we can provide a better service to our customers. But we want to get our people back to work.
Why haven't you resolved this? I mean, it's been going on for weeks, hasn't it, Mr. Haynes? Why is it you've not been able to resolve this?
Well, we've done our very, very best to resolve it. But I think you have to look at the RMT's action nationwide now. Arriva last weekend, balloting on London Underground, on Silverlink, on DLR. And it does look as if the RMT are looking for nationwide strikes at the moment. They will not talk to us at the moment. That's one of our difficulties.
Well, they say one of the reasons they're not talking to you is that you're offering them less now than you were before it all started.
Well, that's always a strange point the RMT makes, because, of course, they rejected all our offers. We haven't come up with an offer yet that they were prepared to accept. One of those offers was 16.5% over 2.5 years. If that wasn't going to settle this, what will?
Okay, I'm sorry if I appear to interrupt you there. Are your passengers entitled to compensation for the distress and delays they're suffering?
Yes, I mean, we've got provision for that. Season ticket extensions, there are procedures in place, and a lot of them will have received the initial compensation already.
Okay.
It's obviously very damaging disruption for many of them.
Okay, well, thank you for taking time out to talk to us, Mr. Haynes.
Time is now 6:46. Relatives and friends of the two British suspected terrorists at Camp X-Ray in Cuba have been talking about their shock at the news of the men's capture. Asif Iqbal and Shafiq Rasool come from the town of Tipton in the West Midlands. Shafiq's family say they want him brought back to Britain.
We've seen pictures of people being shackled up, and they say that he's not been punished, but we've only been told that by the Foreign Office. We don't know that personally, if he's in good health. We haven't seen any pictures or anything of him.
Well, we're joined now from Tipton by the men's local MP, Adrian Bailey. Good morning to you.
Good morning.
Good morning. Now, I understand that you've recently spoken to one of the families of those men. What's been their reaction?
I would say that they're distraught. Here you have a quiet Muslim family that have suddenly found that their son is in a jail facing very serious charges in Cuba, and they're having great difficulty in coping with that. And of course, on top of that, they've got the stress of being the focus of international attention.
Yeah, they certainly have. I mean, how do you think they're going to respond to pieces in today's newspapers? I don't know whether you've seen them, but a number of allegations, and one of them being that they were recruited by a fanatic at a nearby university.
Yeah, they will be amazed. Yesterday, when I spoke to them, they were extremely upset at the press coverage that they had received. They denied some of the allegations entirely, and when I spoke to them yesterday, they said that their son had shown no sympathies whatsoever with Al-Qaeda or the terrorist cause. Indeed, they were outraged by the events on September the 11th. And indeed, he went to Pakistan to do a computer course, which was much cheaper to do in Pakistan than it was in Britain. But they then lost contact with him.
Mm. What about these suggestions that they were members of this something called the Tipton Asian Terror Squad, which was set up at a local school to combat racism from white pupils?
That's a very interesting one. I have been representing this area now for over a year. I have lived here for the last, 13 years, and I have never heard of this organisation. When I've been to the local mosque, all the questions I've received have been on bread and butter issues, houses, jobs, health, etc. I have never heard a political viewpoint that would lead me to believe that any such organisation existed in this area.
I suppose the big question would be then, what can you do to prevent people ending up in fanatical groups?
Well, obviously I'm going to be asking the Foreign Office for the evidence against these lads, and hopefully once we've got a clearer picture of what happened to them when they went to Pakistan, and it would appear subsequently Afghanistan, we can start to piece together the picture and decide what is necessary to be done. What I can say as far as Tipton is concerned, that the family deny that there was any sort of indoctrination here. I have not had any evidence of it. If there is a cell, I can only say that it must be a very small cell indeed, because their views are just not representative of the Muslim community in Tipton.
Adrian Bailey, thank you very much for talking to us this morning.
It's 10 to 7 now. Could we be witnessing a baby boom of a rather different kind? Last week on the programme, we met Mother Ashley Crowe. She'd just given birth to a baby boy the size of an average three-month-old child. Baby Declan weighed a hefty 12 pounds, 4 ounces. That must have been difficult enough, even by caesarean section. But now, meet Natalie Beeson. She gave birth naturally to baby Erin, who is an astounding 13 pounds and 5 ounces, and now she's even bigger, as you can see there. Good morning to you all.
Good morning.
How are you? How's she, by the way?
She's fast asleep at the moment.
And she's how old now?
She's nearly 7 weeks, weeks on Thursday.
And what weight is she now?
Well, last time we weighed about 2 weeks ago, she was 15 pounds, 1 ounce. So
15 pounds?
Possibly nearly 16 pounds.
7 weeks. Now, talk us through this. Talk us through your pregnancy. Did you have any inclination at all that she was going to be so big?
Well, I knew I was big because people kept asking me if I was having twins or triplets as I was walking around work and everything. But no, it was estimated we'd have a 9 or 10 pound baby, but we weren't expecting 13 pounds.
So tell us about the birth. A 4-hour ordeal, I gather.
Yes, it was. All in all, it was almost 24 hours, you know, it was a day, but I went into labour properly and about midnight they started me off and they said they'd try and bring me along naturally, and if that didn't work then they'd rush me in for an emergency caesarean.
You were there, John, were you?
Yeah, I was there on the way.
Feeling every moment with her,
oh,
were you?
Oh, yes.
I mean, it must have been very painful.
It was, yeah, if I'm honest.
I mean, I'm just trying to imagine, but I can't because I'm a fella, but I mean, you know.
That was painful for me as well.
I'll bet it was.
It was very, very painful.
Now, I gather that when she eventually came out, as it were, she was too big for the scales.
Yes, they have little handheld scales that they generally
put babies pounds.
On.
They only went up to 11 pounds.
They had to rush out and find an electronic pair.
So she beat the system as well. Now, what did you do? You'd obviously bought baby clothes for her. Presumably they were too small.
Yep, I had to go home at 4 o'clock in the morning and get some new baby clothes for her, some of the 0 to 3 stuff that we had, rather than the newborn stuff that we had for her. She was just massive, so wouldn't fit into anything.
Now, does this run in the family on either side? I mean, were you big babies or?
We're both 9 pounds.
Both 9 pounds odd,
Not 13.
Didn't you eat masses of chocolate buttons at the end?
Yeah.
Is that anything to do with it?
Yeah, yes, I think so. It's only for about 2 weeks though, but I couldn't stop eating them. It was about 3 packets every day.
Right. Well, she's a very well behaved little baby.
Yeah, she's
not the biggest the hospital have had, I think, that particular hospital.
We think so, yeah.
I believe so. The midwives there couldn't remember a baby bigger, firstborn naturally.
You going to have any more?
Not if I have to have it that way.
Yeah, I'm a member of the caesarean fan club now.
Yeah. I'm in a spare room at the moment.
Yeah. Absolutely. Well, congratulations to you all.
Thank you.
She's a little smasher. I can't say little smasher. She's a big smasher, isn't she?
Yeah, absolutely.
Well done.
Thank you very much.
I think I might try that pose, look.
Yes.
It's mini me.
Mini me, yes, exactly. I'm a lot. Now, just before we go, let's return to the industrial action on South West trains. And an update from our reporter, David Prescott, who's on a journey to see how the emergency timetable's working. So far, he's taken a coach from Alton to Aldershot and by now on a train to Woking. So let's catch up with him now. Dave, you should be arriving in Woking. How are you getting on?
You'd think that, wouldn't you? No, we're not too far away from it at the moment, Penny. After the nightmare of the bus journey, the transfer to train hasn't been too bad, so we should be there in the next couple of minutes. But I've been talking to a few passengers here, and I was just saying, well, who do you blame for this? Is this South West Trains or is this RMT's fault? And he said, well, you know, we don't really mind, we don't really bother anymore. It irritates us, but we just put up with it. I said, why do you do that? He said, well, because we're British.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And I mean, you say it irritates us. I mean, I get very irritated by people on mobile phones, so I'll say goodbye at this moment. Thank you very much. Speak to you again a bit later on. And Southwest Trains has issued a strike timetable for today and tomorrow. You'll find the details on our website, which is, John,
gmtv.co.uk.
Oh, we're so wonderful.
Lots more still to come on GMTV today. We'll be following David's tortuous journey to Waterloo. Going to take him 2 hours, I think, as opposed to the one it should take.
Plus, we've got an exclusive behind-the-scenes look at EastEnders and the chance to win a holiday to Cyprus, and you can pop in and see my mum and dad.
Wouldn't that be nice?
Yeah.
Lovely.
It'd be lovely for them, a little trip over to see the Smiths.
Terrific. Before all that, Claire with some rather different weather, I'm afraid. She's live from the west of Scotland, where it's very wet and very windy.
Your killer isn't a monster with two heads, Jack.
He's under pressure.
Killer 6, Denton CID, no.
With lives at stake.
Don't try to tell me how to carry out an investigation.
And his reputation.
If you're wrong, I'll get thrown to the lions.
If there's anything left of you to throw.
Brand new A Touch of Frost tonight at 9.
This morning, has your love life lost its sizzle? We'll be getting tips from the stars of The Lover's Guide. Phil puts organic food to the test. John Scott's at the Monsters, Inc. premiere. And we'll be clocking on with Clocking Off star Philip Glenister. And, of course, win thousands of money, bunny. That's this morning, every morning.
Don't miss the exclusive interview with screen legend Barbara Windsor. You're in good company with GMTV.
Old stone walls and fields of clover, mountain streams, oaks and beeches. Many things are brought to mind when I smell my riding breeches.
Good morning. This morning I'm down in Gourock in Strathclyde. Behind me is the Firth of Clyde, and I think there's going to be one or two rough ferry crossings this morning. That's because the wind is so strong. It's going to be the key feature of the weather today. Now, the Met Office has issued severe warnings for gusts up to 90 miles an hour. Now, the problem area is going to be central and southern Scotland and also northern England and northern half of Northern Ireland. Now, at the moment, gusts are up to around 50, 60 miles an hour. As we head towards the middle part of the morning into the afternoon, gusts will reach 90 miles an hour before they gradually ease later on. And even across southern Britain, it's going to be a very windy day today with gusts up to 50 miles an hour. For southwestern parts of Scotland, where I am this morning, it's not only the wind, it's also rain. There's bits and spots here at the moment. We're expecting showers to pile in. But for northern Scotland, that's where we are expecting some rain during this morning into this afternoon. And generally across the western part of the country, I think the showers may merge with longer spells of rain. The showers will rattle across the country during the day. I think the best of any brightness, dry weather will be across East Anglia and the southeast during this morning and also into this afternoon. This is the picture of this afternoon across the country. The wind will be still very strong and also those showers could be heavy at times. Now let's have a look at the temperatures. Now temperature not too bad, currently around 8 Celsius here in Gourock. I think it will reach around 10 today, 12 further south across northern half of Scotland. Though it's going to be a very cold day as the winds shift around to more of a northerly direction. But really, the feature of the weather today is the gale force winds. It's going to be very windy indeed, and it actually could cause damage not only to trees but also to buildings. We'll keep you posted through the morning though. Let's have a look at the summary for today's weather. It's a case of showers or rain, especially in the west, and those severe gales.
Well, she's lost the coveted top slot on Pop Idol, but has she found love? Zoe Birkett joins us live later on. Yeah, it's 2 minutes to seven. It's Monday, it's the 28th of January. Morning to you.
Good morning, you're starting another week with GMTV today.